Day all generations will call me. him and appealed to him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, suffering dreadfully." He said to him, "I will come and cure him." The centurion said in reply, "Lord, I am not worthy to have you enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too am a man subject to authority, with soldiers subject to me. And I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come here,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed and said to those following him, "Amen, I say to you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith. I say to you, many will come from the east and the west and will recline with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at the banquet in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom will be driven out into the outer darkness, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth." And Jesus said to the centurion, "You may go. As you have believed, let it be done for you." And at that very hour, his servant was healed. Jesus entered the house of Peter and saw his mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever. He touched her hand. The fever left her, and she rose and waited on him. When it was evening, they brought him many who were possessed by demons, and he drove out the spirits by a word and cured all the sick, to fulfill what had been said by Isaiah the prophet, "He took away our infirmities and bore our diseases." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The healing ministry of Jesus. How do we understand it? How beautiful this healing ministry of Jesus is. God has blessed us with a physical body. And this physical body, because of original sin, becomes weakened, becomes afflicted with pain and suffering and disease. However, the body is God's gift to us. It is the vehicle in which grace comes in and penetrates the soul. It is a mystery, that is, human suffering, as long as we understand it to be redemptive. As long as we understand that our human suffering also is to match the very sufferings in which Jesus bore, in which Isaiah prophesied. He took away our infirmities and bore our diseases. We are one with him. We're one with him in humanity, and we are joined to his divinity. By the mere reception of the sacraments, How beautiful it is that we are one with God. And I know sometimes it's very difficult even to comprehend that. But God, in his beautiful humility, came to us just like us, suffered like us in every way, bore our infirmities and our sicknesses, and took them to the cross. We're one with him. We place the cross over our bodies in prayer, not as a Catholic ritual gesture, but as a theological meaning. In fact, everything we do as far as ritual is not to be seen isolated to the lived experience. It is to be commingled as one. It's always both and, not either or. It's not just our Catholic life in a church building, but it's our Catholic life everywhere we go. We come here to be fortified and nourished by him. How beautiful is the celebration of Holy Mass and the reception of communion. Sometimes we call the sacrament of the sick the sacrament of healing. And rightly so. However, the Eucharist is the sacrament of healing par excellence. The Church teaches that. Did you hear the Gospel about the centurion? We say the same thing. When the priest holds up the host, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to suffer. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Both then, not either or. The sacrament of the Eucharist is the sacrament of healing. It is Christ coming to us, touching our very being. That's why the Church so vividly and poignantly describes the sacraments as encounters with the risen Christ. He comes to us as divine physician, as redeemer and savior, as our brother. And how beautiful this is. How beautiful do we understand Christ's miracles as such? We understand, don't we, that the miracles are not one-sided. That the miracles affect body so it could affect the soul. It's just not zapping back into where I was before, Lord. Lord, bring me healing. Bring me healing through my body as it penetrates my soul. Let this suffering and let this healing be redemptive for my spiritual life. Sometimes we don't always think of that, do we? We just want the body to be healed. And yet if we study the Gospels, we know that that's really not the case or the point of why Jesus has come as healer. He's just not this healing guru that comes and snaps everybody into place. There's something deeper going on in the healing ministry of Jesus. And it takes on the part of the person faith. How do you identify with him? How do you understand who he is in relationship to us and the world? Sometimes Jesus will say, as you hear, "Don't tell anybody what I've just done." You and I would say, "Why not?" Jesus tells them, "Don't." Remember, he says, "Just go yourself to the priest, and what Moses prescribed, that would be enough for them." Again, we understand this to be the reason that's very clear. That sensationalism of people just running to Jesus to have a quick fix has nothing to do with faith. They just want to be cured, right? They just want to be healed. They just want the human part of it. They're lacking the faith, divine part of it. So Jesus, let them come there. You don't have to go and publicize this. You don't have to be my marketer. What they see will be enough. You see that today, too. So all that we know about Jesus, all that we know about the sacraments, are they beating down our doors? No. There has to be a point where people take a leap of faith. It's here. The medicine is here. The healing is here. You have to desire, and you have to have the faith for it. And some people are not ready. Go ask anyone who's struggling with an addiction. "No, I'll take care of it. It's only one drink. No, it's only one pill to ease the pain." And it becomes 2 days, 2 months, 2 years. 5 years. And when do they realize it? When they become helpless. When they become helpless. When they recognize that a power higher than they can do this. Now are you ready? I'm ready. You ever hear that line in scripture? "Sir, we want to see Jesus." Today on Saturday, we try our best within the liturgical calendar to celebrate one of the masses of the collection of masses of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And today, the church, how beautifully and aptly put, is the church, Blessed Mother's Mass for healing. How very nice. Health of the sick. She holds the dying Jesus as she gazes upon him, as she laments. So healing is not only body, right? It's mind, too. Some people who suffer with trouble with the mind say to themselves, "I wish I was physically sick." Because sometimes they believe that the sickness of the mind is more tragic than the sickness of the body. And those who are suffering in spirit, they say the same thing about the other two. That's why you always hear the language of the church in body, mind, or spirit, healing. I know we publicly make that prayer and that statement. And that's what it is. The sacraments are healing for body, for mind, and for the soul. So how beautiful Isaiah prophesied. He has come to take our infirmities and he has come to bear our diseases. Let us at every Mass place all of our sins, anxieties, fears, and troubles on this altar, the altar of the cross, so that Jesus may take them and to heal us in body, mind, and soul. After reflecting on God's holy word, let us now place these petitions before the Lord with confidence and trust.
For missionaries, may they be guided, protected, and empowered by the Holy Spirit as they testify to the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For national and local leaders, may the God of peace sow within them seeds of desire for justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and those in chronic pain, may God bring healing and relief into their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this faith community, may the saving grace of Christ be our hope and our refuge. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, may they experience fullness of joy with God and the saints in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and suffering, Mike Marshall, Grace Domenico, Tom DeSantis, Margaret Deshawn, and all those on our prayer list, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of Matthew Perel, for which this Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also pray for the spiritual and temporal needs of St. Mary's Parish, so that all of us may further the mission of Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, especially for members of our own parish family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let us continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in Florida who have experienced the terrible collapse of that condominium. Let us pray for all the essential and first responders, all those who work for the well-being and the healing ministry that comes from Jesus to them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we place these petitions before you. If they are in accord with your holy will, we ask you to grant them through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth, work.
human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed
are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine, work with human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, sisters and brothers, my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good of all
the
Church.
Look, O Lord, upon the prayers and offerings of your faithful, presented in the commemoration of Blessed Mary, the Mother of God, that they may be and may confirm in us your help and forgiveness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in a wonderful way you make the Blessed Virgin Mary a share, a special one, in the mystery of pain. She now shines radiantly as a sign of health, of healing, and of divine hope for the sick who call on her patronage. To all who look up to her in prayer, she is the model of perfect acceptance of your will, and a wholehearted conformity with Christ, who out of love for us endured our weakness and bore our sufferings. Through Christ, the angels of heaven offer their prayer of adoration as they rejoice in your presence forever. May our voices be one with theirs in their triumphant hymn of praise. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. All generations will call me blessed, for God has looked on his lowly handmaid.
Thank you. Like I mentioned, the good news is that we'll be starting next Saturday to hear confessions in the morning, as well as the afternoon. So after the 9 o'clock Mass on Saturday, beginning next Saturday, we'll have the availability of confession, and then again, of course, in the afternoon before the 4 o'clock Mass. Also, I'm very happy in a special way to Patty Carmody, because every July 4th, we celebrate and pray the Patriotic Rosary. This year, July 4th is on a Sunday, so we will be anticipating on Saturday, July the 3rd, next Saturday, at 8 o'clock, beginning at 8 a.m., with the Patriotic Rosary, her and all her team members who are assisting her with that will be leading us in the Patriotic Rosary, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. So I'm happy to Patty Carmody and all those people that she has with her. Also, as you know, finally, we are blessed to have two members of the Roman Catholic clergy assisting us on the weekend. The first one being Deacon Peter Burkhardt. Deacon Peter is a member of St. Mary's Parish with his dear wife, Marge. They attend the 4 o'clock Mass on Saturday. Deacon Peter has been ordained to the diaconate in 2001. He's 20 years a deacon, and he is officially retired from his day job and also from the diaconate. But he had come to me and he asked if he could be serving here at our parish with the Mass at 4 o'clock on Saturday. So I'm happy to bring him on for that. And he also said that he would be happy to take his turn in baptisms. So, as you know, we do it twice a month, and I have the privilege of baptizing in June. Deacon Don is baptizing in July, and then Deacon Peter will take his turn in August, and I'll be September, October, you know how it goes. Mickey, Mike, all that. So it'll be Deacon Peter will also be helping us with that. So that's a blessing. And also, we're happy to have Monsignor Mesher. Monsignor Mesher is a faculty member of St. Charles Seminary and also the Chancellor for the Archdiocese of Philadelphia. This will be his weekend assignment. So he begins, of course, tomorrow at the 10:30 Mass and the 12 noon Mass. So how beautiful is that? You can read about Monsignor Mesher's bio in the bulletin this weekend in the feature page, all about him. He is